It is my pleasure to introduce you to Mr. Dinesh Gupta, a senior professional in technology consulting. Dinesh has spent 20 plus years of his working career in multiple industries and organizations in UK, Europe, Japan, and India. Maybe based in the UK from where he joins. We are already three time zones here, US, US, India, and UK. And he works for a global firm in their advisory function. In terms of his academic qualifications, Dinesh is a chartered accountant who gravitated towards information technology, where he has spent the majority of his working career so far. This is especially salient given the question that came up yesterday when somebody said people are working in fields that are outside of their academic qualification, a trend you commonly see in not only India, but also in the US. And Dinesh is suitably positioned to sort of speak about why he changed directions. Dinesh is passionate about sharing his experiences with aspiring professionals to help them make the right choices on career front. And so he very generously agreed to talk to you today. In the interest of complete disclosure, let me share that Dinesh is my cousin, a younger brother for whom I have the utmost affection and respect, a personal relationship. And as Dinesh will be probably the first to accept, please feel free to ask whatever relevant questions that come up during action. But the personal relationship has nothing to do with your discretion to ask questions. Our goal is to get you to think deeply about issues related to working, operating in the global economy, because this is an international business. That's our goal. The format for today's interaction will be that I will start by asking some questions and then we will open the floor for questions from students. Dinesh, are you ready?
Yes, Vishal. Thanks very much. And I must say, I'm very excited. I don't do these sessions very often. So thanks for inviting. Thanks for making me part of this. And I'm really hoping that, you know, whatever my experience is, whatever my views are, students can benefit from it and we can have a interactive and a productive session. Thanks, Vishal.
Thank you, Dinesh. Let me start with the first question. Can you share with the audience something about your current professional life? What do you do and about your personal life? Just brief information.
Sure, Vishal. So as Vishal, you mentioned, I am working in a big four global consultancy firm. My role is within the business consulting side. And to be more specific, I help corporates or even government functions in their financial transformation journeys. Now, this is something which is a change I've seen recently. So previously, the words that were used was change, implementing something new. Now, the most common word you see or hear is transformation. So finance side of transformation, that is what I help people with, organizations with. Now, I'm based in the UK for the last 2 years. Prior to that, I was in India for nearly 7 years. And prior to that, I was again in UK for 10 years. So I have been on a journey to and fro from India to UK. But it has been all good experiences. In terms of my work experiences in India, the key organizations I worked for are Hero MotoCorp. Now that was called Hero Honda at that time when the joint venture between Hero and Honda was there. Another company which I worked for and have very fond memories is ITC. That has been a more recent experience. Within UK, the key companies, apart from my current organization, are Novartis Pharmaceuticals and Warner Brothers Media Company. So yeah, that is my broad experience. And as you mentioned, it has been mainly in finance and information technology, plus, of course, business consulting, which I'm doing now.
Okay, thank you. Can you share briefly about your childhood, college, and sort of professional background, just so we know where
yes. So my upbringing was in Punjab, a small town, township in Punjab, in Hoshiarpur district. Being the son of a government officer, an honest government officer, so it was a very humble upbringing. So me and my sister, so we grew up there, studied in a school there. Then the college was primarily for class 11th and 12th, again in Punjab. The professional qualification, as you mentioned, Vishal, I'm a chartered accountant. I did my CA from Delhi. The firm which I joined for training for articleship. So if students don't know, in CA you have to do 3 years of training. It is called articleship, and I did it from SB Billy Moriya, which is a very old prestigious firm, which is part of Deloitte now, Deloitte India. So that is my qualification. And after CA, Hero Honda was my first job in the finance function.
So your first job was in the field that you were academically qualified. When did you make the transition to IT?
It just happened, Vishal. So the intention was to serve in the area of finance and accounts. And that is where I started. Now, in the year 2000 or so, Hero Honda decided to implement ERP. So I'm sure students would know, but if some of them don't know about ERP, so ERP is a business application software, a generic term used for enterprise resource planning softwares, which help organizations manage their functions, back-end and front-end functions, more seamlessly using IT applications. So Hero Honda decided to implement an ERP solution, and the name of that solution was SAP, SAP. The implementation was done by Siemens Information Systems. Now, the way ERP implementations work is you have a service provider, a business integrator stroke system integrator, which is an external vendor. And then you have a core internal team, because it is very important that you build a solution, an IT solution or a business IT solution using the knowledge of your internal processes, which your internal team would have. So as part of that project, I was asked to represent the finance team of Hero Honda's Gurgaon plant. So they used to manufacture motorcycles there, still they do. So I represented the finance team of Gurgaon plant, and that was my entry into IT really. Spent a year or so working with the external service provider to implement the solution, and another year or so to support it, because implementing the solution is not end of it. You have to make it work. And unless you make it work, it is not a good investment. So after that, I thought it sounds interesting, probably more interesting than finance and accounts at that time. And then I moved into IT. That was my experience.
Okay, great. We are going to slightly change tracks now. You've lived in England for several years in the UK.
Yes.
And we have a student here who did his undergraduate from the UK, University of Bristol. Then joined IIM. In your view, how is India seen in the United Kingdom?
Yes, I mean, I have very positive vibes, positive experience, positive feeling. My experience is Indians are respected. They are known for being hard workers. They are known for being, educationally qualified. Unlike some of the other, ethnic population. So I would say highly respected. And I see it all around me, even the organization. So I work for KPMG in the UK. Even in KPMG, I see the Indians. And I must say, these are second and third generation Indians. Who are doing even better than the local population. They are so very well integrated, not only work-wise, but culturally, socially. I guess they would find India as a foreign country now. So their country is UK, and they have integrated well. Now, for people like us, I'm a first generation Indian, still a lot of respect for what we do and what we can contribute. But I guess, again, it's a personal thing, but the level of cultural and social integration that you would see could probably vary between person to person, people to people. So most of the time, our social circle is Indians, and that is who we meet. But work-wise, I guess we are highly, Indians are highly respected. And also, that is about Indians living in the UK. But even for Indians living in India, I guess there is a lot of respect here for the contributions Indians are able to make. The only there could be more things, but the only thing that comes to my mind where probably there could be some level of improvement is India is, it is because of the way organizations are structured. India is seen more as a BPO destination. So Indians are seen as following the processes that have been created, and they do it very well from India, from the BPOs. That is the kind of area where I would probably see more of a lead or leadership or innovation coming forward. Yeah.
Okay, great. Now, you've also lived in India for several years. Of course, you grew up in India, but more recently you worked in Calcutta and in Gurgaon yes. In India. In your view, how do Indians view the United Kingdom?
I think Indians, it is again, you're basically based on your background, where your upbringing, where you have lived and how you have lived. So the place I come from, for example, from Punjab, so a lot of people view UK as somewhere where, a place where they have to reach by hook or crook, paying travel agents a lot of money and then doing some, very, very basic jobs here. Which they would never do in India. That's a fact. But for the educated class, for the people who want to make a career in any of the professional areas. So I guess if I talk about my experience, it has been great. You can say in every respect, even culturally, you get to enjoy all your festivals. A lot of Indian population, food-wise, people-wise, it has been really, really great. And I guess even, when I talk to my friends, the outcome most of the time on this topic is that outside India, probably UK is the destination, the country you would want to go to. Probably also because of the proximity to India, you can go to your parents very quickly, all those things. And I guess, it takes some time to integrate with the local population, to understand, how Britishers, feel and talk and behave. For example, a couple of things which I learned by experience. So Britishers, they would always be diplomatically correct, right? They would laugh probably from the outside, but you never know what is going inside, right? They would not always mean what they say. They could say you are a star, right? But they may not mean that. So nothing bad about it. It's just the culture, just the way they have been brought up, just the way they behave. So I think once that understanding is there, which obviously comes with time, it's a great place to live. No issues, Vishal.
We often hear Indians talk about India becoming a global superpower. Now, you've worked in India, you worked in Japan, you worked in the UK. What do you think are some of the the positive forces that encourage India in this direction. So we'll talk about the positive. And what do you think are some of the negative forces? So first the positives and then the negatives, or vice versa, whichever way you choose, that sort of help or impede India from attaining that position that many young people in India hope for.
Yeah, I mean, we have been hearing about India again, Vishal, as I mean, I don't think I need to say this, but still I will say these are all my views, personal views, and that is what I'm here for, to share my views. So we have been hearing about India becoming a superpower for quite some time now, isn't it? Since we were children. But the way it is happening is probably we are taking one step forward and two step backwards. If you look at the strengths in India, there are so many strengths, right? And as per me, the biggest strength is the percentage of young population, the youth. I mean, if you look at Europe, UK, Europe, even China, or so many other countries, the percentage of youth is significantly less than what you would see in India. But that's a plus and a minus both, isn't it? If you kind of lead the youth in the right direction, that is an asset, right? But if you are not providing enough opportunities, if you are not helping them, then this can be a disaster as well. So I guess that counts on both the sides. But otherwise, English as a language, one of the reasons we are so quick to adapt adjust in a country like UK or US is our language. We understand English, we speak English very fluently, and that is what we have been doing. I mean, we should not, underestimate the power of this language. Without this language, it is indeed difficult to achieve what Indian, people have achieved globally, particularly in the UK and US. There could be so many other factors, Vishal. Resources, Indian resources in terms of water, land resources, but that has been there for ages, right? We have not been able to exploit those. I think that is the challenge. So there is a positive, but there is a challenge that sits at the same level, right? I would not talk because it's a session about sharing experiences and knowledge, so I will not talk on the political side. But obviously, there is a big element of political will. So and the views could be different from one person to the other. So political will, if it is there, it is a big asset, right? It can take the country forward. And the lack of political will, obviously, it can take you backward. What else? I think the other thing I can think of is military strength, right? So we have seen, for example, China, the way it has come up, they made some strong decisions, which probably could not be made in a democratic country like ours. But at the same time, they gave equal or more focus on their military side. So because to help expand, not geographically, but expand your businesses, expand your economy, the world should know that you have a good military strength, not to disturb you while you are doing that. So I guess all these things, I would see they are positives, but as I said, there's a parallel negative sitting at the same level.
So Dinesh, you said one step forward, two steps backward. Was that just a figure of speech, or did you mean it sort of in a more literal sense? Because I tell students that the way I see India's development is three steps forward, two steps backward, which means overall it's progress, but there are setbacks. Your expression seemed to suggest you see overall decline, only some progression, but overall decline. Is there?
Yes, no, thanks for asking this. I think what I meant, probably I should have made it clearer. What I meant is in relative terms, not absolute terms. So in absolute terms, India is definitely moving forward. But see, when you see where we stand globally, I would say we are not moving at a pace at which we should move, right? Probably that is what I meant. Now, again, coming back to political will, there is any decision made by any government to make lives better, to help the economy, I guess, irrespective of who is in power or who is in opposition, I think the environment is such that whoever is in power is making the wrong decision, which is very different from what we see here in UK. So if something needs to be done for the people of the country, it could be in terms of, coming up with a vaccination quickly, or, administering that vaccination, or any other decision. If it is the right thing to do for the people, everyone will stand behind it, irrespective of the party, the political party they belong to. So I guess in that perspective, I would say, India is not India is, not making the right progress.
Okay. Dinesh, now I'm going to open the floor for questions from the students. So we'll see if the students have any questions.
Sure, Vishal.
Anyone?
Hello, sir. Good evening. Rahul this side.
Good evening, Rahul.
Yes, sir. So I just want to ask that you have worked in India at corporate, and you work at UK also. So when you are shifting from here to there, so I want to ask about the corporate culture. So whether it is different from India and in UK, or you find it similar? And if it is different, so do you take some time to adapt to that culture, or you find it easy?
Okay. Now that's a very good question. So again, my personal experience, Rahul, is, so the work cultures are a bit different, and I will explain how. So what I find is in UK, your personal life is given equal importance as well. So I can tell in my office that today I have to attend a parents teachers meeting at school, or I want to take my daughter somewhere. That is accepted as a valid reason. People do not call you over the weekends or late evenings unless there is an absolute emergency. So this is a general environment. There could be exceptions. In India, I would categorize, again, based on my experience, the work culture into two broad parts. One is the work culture in multinationals or even big Indian corporates like ITC. The second could be the family-driven businesses. My last role, which I did not mention, a brief role was in the Thapar Group in Kolkata, where I was their group CIO. Now, in the family-driven businesses, the work environment could be really challenging. Some people adapt to it better than the others. So if I talk about myself, I feel people can call you anywhere, anytime you don't have a personal life. Now, again, some family businesses could be better than the others. But that was the overall, impression I had, that, you don't get much of a personal space in these businesses. But in ITC, it was quite okay. Not as good as UK, but quite okay. Now, in terms of adapting from Indian culture to UK culture, I think that part of adaptation is easy. When you see a better thing for you, or better prospect for you, or better environment for you, you tend to adapt easily. But if I go from UK to India, unless I'm working in a multinational or a corporate with very good employee-centric policies, I would probably struggle.
So Dinesh, can you give an example, building on Rahul's question, of one issue that you struggled with when you moved from the UK to India in terms of company culture?
Yes, I mean, Vishal, as you would know, when I decided to move from UK to India, I moved to do something on my own, to run my own company and my own business for 2 years before joining ITC. Now, that had its own challenges because in India, a couple of things I would say as a business as well, and then I will come to as an employee. So when I do a project for a company, and my projects, my services were on the information technology side. So providing them consulting services on what a good practice is, what the internal controls are in finance and all, you would be able to do your project, but the client would never be able to define the or freeze the scope completely. Even at the end, you will find people coming back to you and saying, can you do this as well? And I would say, no, that was not part of the contract, but it does not matter really. It does not matter because you are still, you know, you still have 25% or even 50% of your payment, which is with them. So a lot of challenges. And as an employee, as I said, in ITC, I had a great, you know, work environment. But one issue I would recall is, I think just building upon what I said to Rahul. So I would get a call at 11:30 in the night, just because my boss thinks it is important. It is not critical. It is not, showstopper in business terms, but it is important for him for other reasons, for maybe political reasons, for others. I have a lot of respect for Indian businesses and, my colleagues there. There could be, differences from one company to the other, but this is what I found broadly. That is my experience.
Okay. Questions from other students?
This is Akash.
Hi, Akash.
So my question is, hi, sir. So what parts of your job do you find most challenging? And yes, sir. And there is a follow-up question I would ask later on.
Again, it's a question, obviously, which is specific to my personality and specific to me, the way you have asked it, Akash. So working in KPMG, so if I talk about the good part, so I enjoy my client meetings, I enjoy working on solution design, but where I struggle is, so I'll give you an example. So in December, we had a Christmas get together. Obviously it was virtual because of the situation. And you are expected to contribute, in those kind of informal get togethers. And the music that was being played, so there was a quiz. The music was, the songs were getting played. There was a quiz after that. And it was all, Hollywood songs or English songs. Now, again, some people understand and some people can participate real well, but that is not me. I find it difficult because I've grown up and grown up hearing Bollywood songs, old songs, Kishore Da songs. So I find that environment difficult to handle because I can't contribute and I am kind of a mute spectator. But otherwise, work-wise, I enjoy doing everything that I'm doing.
Akash,
thank you, sir.
Question.
Yes, sir. So which seasons of the year are toughest in your job?
So Akash, you have to probably elaborate a bit more. When you say seasons, what do you mean?
Like it, talking about which months do you have a lot of work, which involves a lot of work, like whether yes. It is in the summer, like in April or...
Okay. Yes. Now, I mean, the field I am in, the business consulting field, for us, it does not matter. I mean, KPMG has an audit practice as well, a big audit practice, and their work is very, it is seasonal. So when you are close to year end, then they will have a lot of work. They will do, 15, 16 hours a day because that is the nature of their work. other time they'll be having less work. But for me as a business consultant, it does not matter. The ups and downs in terms of work volume that we see is, so for example, I've taken an assignment to work on finance transformation. When we are at the initial stage of that project, it could be, you know, it would not be that high level of work. I mean, that extreme busyness of work. But when we are towards the implementation, towards the go live phases, then we tend to work harder, you know, put more number of hours in a day. So that is the kind of, that is the nature of my work, Akash.
Dinesh, building on Akash's question, my follow-up question is, when you worked in India, either as a young person in Hero Honda or sort of as a more experienced person in ITC, what was the best part of your jobs? Akash asked you about the best part of your job in the UK, or what part right. you like. But I'm sure there must have been parts of working in India that you liked.
So, yes. I guess it is, again, the softer side, I would say. So relating to people, relating to everything more. So in ITC, we implemented a big business applications project, and I was leading it from the ITC side, and our implementation partners were Accenture. My softer side of my relationships with Accenture, my team, going for evening get-togethers, the team building that I could do there, I will struggle to do here. So even though the quality of work is better here, so I tend to work on the leading practices, best practices. I know what are the global design principles of everything I work on. You know, the exposure is more and the work-life balance is better, as I said. But, you know, getting to engage with my team better, that is something I enjoyed doing in India, and I could do it easily. I mean, all my colleagues from India are still part of my network. We talk, and you know, you relate to that.
Great. Other questions from the students?
Hello, sir. This is Malay.
Hi, Malay.
Sir, my question is with respect to the diversity of roles and responsibility, that in which country that you find that roles and responsibilities were very dynamic, not limited to your job role that you were into. And how did you decide to shift from CA to consultant?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So let me think and handle the first part of your question. So diversity of roles that a person is able to do or is asked to do. So I guess the general, again, there could be exceptions, Malay, but the general culture here in the UK is you tend to be specialist in an area. So if I join an organization, it could be BT, British Telecom, or British Petroleum, whoever, right? I would be expected to contribute in the area I have expertise in. People would not expect me to go beyond it. And that is the way it is. People are happy as well. I mean, I see people who are 50, 55 years of age, happily doing a small part of the job. On the information technology side, it could be coding, or even could be a part of the change management, you know, or even working in the PMO office. So they are happily doing it. No one questions them, you know, why on earth could you be doing this a small part of the job at the age of 50, 55, whatever. That, however, is different in the consulting firms. For example, in a firm like KPMG, Accenture, EY, Deloitte, etc., people, the consultants tend to expand beyond what they are doing, and it is appreciated. So if you take the onus to contribute in a different area, that is appreciated, and you are encouraged generally. So that is the difference between industry and consulting world here. In India, I guess, again, that is based on my experience. I found that I could go into more areas more easily, and it was appreciated even in the industry. So, for example, I'll tell you, I joined ITC not as a IT head of for the division. I joined ITC as a head of business application to handle their ITC hotels and ITC lifestyle retail businesses. But you know, 1.5 years into that role, I was asked to take up the role of a divisional CIO for their lifestyle retail business. And that was, I could not have imagined it here. So working into different, going into different areas, I think that is appreciated or encouraged even in industry, more in India. Now, to your, first of all, did I reply your question, Ale?
Yes, sir, very well. Yes.
Okay, great, thanks. Now, your second question about how I moved into IT from, or consulting from finance. I guess, as I said, it happened, it was not by choice. It just happened. So when you are working in finance and you are asked to be a part of a core team, which is implementing that business application solution. And then, you know, I started enjoying that more than my desk job in finance and accounts. And I thought that gives me an opportunity to travel the world as well, because IT was very sought after field at that time, particularly. And you could get global exposure by going into that area. So that is how it happened. And I guess it is not something unusual these days. You find people who are finance professionals or engineers working in IT, and it happens. And even in banks, you see engineers, you see, you know, even technologists working in banks. It happens all the time.
Dinesh, we have a question in the chat box. And the question is, what are the differences you've noticed during the digital transformation across multiple sectors, from Rahul Chaudhary?
Right. Okay, thanks, Rahul. Again, it's a very, very broad question. Now, when we talk about digital transformation, right, is your question that which sector is adopting or more prone to adopting digital transformation than the other? If that is the question, I guess I can start with that, and then you can tell me whether you need something else. I think these sectors which are more business to customer focused, B2C. So you see FMCG, you see retail. Again, part of retail is, you know, apparels and garments. Even the professional services. I would say these sectors, again, there could be more, but these sectors are the ones which immediately come to mind, where you interact with a wider customer base, and hence the need for digital transformation. And when I say digital transformation, it could be such a wide topic. It could mean that you need to work on all the elements of your technology domain roadmap. It could be related to your business applications. It could be related to your infrastructure, technology infrastructure, system integrations. It could relate to your information security. And it could relate to a big topic of data and analytics, very, very important and hot topic. It could relate to data science. It could relate to artificial intelligence and machine learning. It could relate to a very niche, I mean, not niche from a customer perspective, from a backend perspective, area of DevSecOps. So various elements of digitization. And I think the way it is looked at by people who are on the receiving side, for example, people in the business, not in the technology, or people who are our customers, so they see the digitization in the form of the services that are being offered to them. For example, in ITC, we started working on something called omnichannel. So irrespective of where the customer is, they can order from using different options. Could be by phone, could be by on website, could be by visiting to the store, could be by email, right? And the way they can be delivered the product, which was apparels, it could be, you know, seamless. It could be that customer can come and collect this item, which is called click and collect. It could be that the item is dispatched to them. It could be that, you know, customer comes to the store, they don't find the item, but immediately technology helps to reserve from a different store because they couldn't find it. The size was not there. The color was not there, you know? So you immediately, the store manager reserves from a different store and they get it next day. Or if that store is nearby, the customer goes and collects it from there. So seamless interaction, seamless interface. So does it answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Dinesh, sir, so given that
I have one question. Yeah.
Who's this?
Sir, I'm Nishant Kumar.
Okay, Nishant, you get the last question and then we sort of move towards winding it up.
Good evening, sir. So I'm Nishant Kumar. So, sir, my question is with regards to Brexit. Like, Brexit was in force last year. So, what is the public sentiment in UK regarding like globalization? Are they moving towards protectionism? And in the professional, sir, in your professional life, like, what is the impact of Brexit in businesses and all that? We have read recent articles like HSBC or and different British companies. They are thinking about moving their headquarters to European Union in order to have a better business performance. So what is your view regarding it?
Right. So Nishant, in no way I'm an expert on Brexit, but let me give you a brief on what I understand, what my experience has been so far. First of all, I think Brexit came from, you know, sentiments rather than anything to do with business and economy. Because of the history, Britishers are very proud people. They enjoy, they cherish their history and they have ruled the world, right? So I think the decision was more related to those kind of sentiments. So being independent rather than part of someone else. And also some things to do with politics. So we'll not go into detail on that. Now, in terms of the impact of Brexit, because it took a long time to implement it, so I guess a lot of businesses put together their plans, readiness plans. So they had some contingency plans. Now these contingency plans got converted into the actual proper business plans. Majority of the businesses, it could be KPMG or it could be Amazon, right? So they already operate from different countries. So global companies operate from different countries. So for them, the impact is not significant. It is more on what should appear on the invoice. Are you still charging that much VAT? Or so what is the taxation from invoice perspective, from a tax determination and submission perspective? Now, in terms of logistics or supply chains, yes, there could be some companies, as you mentioned, banks and all, who, or even, you know, FMCG and retail companies, global ones, who could think of moving their supply chains, their warehouses, their distribution points to take benefits of the new, taxation or ease of doing things in the new world. But I don't know a lot about that. There could be a lot of cases like that. Overall, in the UK, living in the UK, the way I see it is, there's not a huge impact on businesses because of this. However, there could be impact on people. When I say impact on people, so just to share something with you. So for example, at the moment, UK does not have a point-based system for immigration, like they used to have for highly skilled migrants previously. Now, because of Brexit, they are expecting that probably they will need more people to come to UK from non-European countries, because the people who have come from Europe who do not qualify a certain criteria, they may go back. So within 2021, it is expected that UK will bring up a point-based visa system, something on the lines of highly skilled migrant program, which could help or which could be beneficial to people to people in India or other countries where we have, you know, a lot of people with, you know, good skills and they want to work in a country like UK. So these are the impacts on people, I guess, good impacts, positive impacts. If you think about people who plan to move to UK going forward, they will have more opportunities. That is my personal opinion.
Thank you, sir.
Dinesh, before I move to sort of my last question, can we take another question from the students in the chat box? And the question is, did you find any challenges while switching across industries?
I guess, yes, the challenges are there, but I enjoyed it. So moving from apparel retail to this Thapar group, where it was logistics, it was aquaculture and real estate, the challenge is to understand the business, but that is an interesting side as well. So people who want to learn new things, who want to explore new things, I must say though that understanding the business is, I mean, I can't emphasize how important it is to understand the business before you start delivering on your job role. So I could be part of an IT team, but I would not be able to deliver unless I know what the business is, what are the strengths and the challenges of the business, what the business leaders, the business heads want 1 year down the line, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years down the line. So yes, challenges are there in terms of understanding the new business. But that is a very interesting aspect of my career, which I cherished.
So Dinesh, we'll now move to my last question for the day. I know we've already taken more than 45 minutes of your time when that
no worries, Vishal.
You had promised. So thanks for your patience. My last question is, based on your experiences so far, what advice would you offer to our students in terms of making good career choices to work in a globalized world?
Yeah, I think, again, based on my experience, I can talk about a few things. I guess one of the most important things I realize is, which I tell my children as well, that having a clarity on your long-term goals, what you want to do in long-term, that clarity is so important that it can't be overemphasized. It is the key to building a successful career. Now, what you want to do long-term could be driven by a lot of things. Every person has their personal drivers, right? Some of the common drivers could be money, power, you know, good family life, you know, social life, etc. But what I find at this stage of my career is having an objective which is beyond these personal goals. So something, while working on something on my day job, if I can say contribute to the society, if I can pay back, if I can do something which the world needs. So I fully understand that, you know, you would want to do something which is of interest, which is great. You should do what is of interest, right? But at the same time, see if that can relate to what the world needs as well. And irrespective of what you do, and I am saying again, you know, I give the same advice to my kids as well. So the key is to be good in that. I think being a journalist, again, as per my opinion, does not help a lot. You can be a journalist. You can talk about, you can be good at a lot of topics, but having a specialization, being really good at something, probably better than the others, and keeping yourself updated. I mean, the world is changing fast, right? Particularly in the technology side. So keeping yourself updated that is so important. And I guess one thing, again, this may sound spiritual, but I thought I'll speak about this just in one sentence. And this has helped me a lot, Vishal. Having that alignment between, you know, your mind, body, and emotions, that helps. If that alignment is there, so you tend to be, you know, doing the right things, even with less effort, and you tend to be happier. That is what I feel.
Great. Thank you, Dinesh. I don't know about the students, but I've been taking lots of notes as you were speaking. So your views, your experiences have helped me, you know, as you could probably tell by the notes I was taking. But we'll take this opportunity to thank you very much for your time. And can the students connect with you on LinkedIn or anything if they have further questions?
Yes, of course. I would love to. In fact, Vishal, as you would know, that is my way of you know, giving back to an extent. Great. So I would love to use my experience to help the students. Why not? And thank you very much, Vishal, for having me here.
Thank you, Dinesh. Take care. Yes. Have a good day.
Thanks. Bye.